So after saying that, I want to ask Tommaso to prepare his presentation, and he will. Unfortunately, I never had the abstract of his talk. I'm more or less aware of what he's going to present, I suppose. Grzegorz, you want to say something?
Is it me or is it Tommaso who is?
No. Sorry. I made a mistake. Grzegorz, it is your turn. I'm very sorry. So, are you able to? Sorry, Tommaso. Are you able to share your screen? Because I'm not sure if you are a host right now. There you go. So Grzegorz, thank you very much for accepting the invitation and for the nice discussion yesterday. And then I will give you your 25 minutes right now. Okay. And please, you can start whenever you want.
So I would like to start by thanking you and all the organizers for organizing this very nice symposium, and for giving me the opportunity to talk to you about some of the theories that I've been working on. So I'm going to talk about theories for glassy dynamics, and I should acknowledge collaborations and discussions with people listed here. And by the way, can you see my pointer?
Yes, I can.
Yes.
Okay. And I would also like to acknowledge discussions with my fellow speakers in this session, Tommaso and Thomas. So the subject, the title of today's session is the word unified theoretical description of the glass transition. I will be mostly talking about the dynamics, but I should start by reminding everybody that there are interesting phenomena that happen outside of the dynamics. Glass transition as encountered in the lab consists of forming an amorphous solid when a liquid is supercooled past its melting temperature. The transition to this amorphous solid is a little bit rounded off, but still rather sharp. The location of the transition depends on the cooling rate. So this putative transition is really a kinetic crossover. There are many interesting questions that can be asked about this transition and about the response of the glass to external perturbations. One of the questions that I was struggling with for quite some time and I'm still thinking about is how can an amorphous structure that is very similar to structure of a liquid, how can it exhibit elastic response? And we published some work on this subject. Other people contributed, I don't think. I think it's still an open area of research. Now, what we are interested in here is slowing down. That's the most spectacular phenomenon that happens upon approaching the glass transition. We can see slowing down as measured here by viscosity plotted as a function of inverse temperature. We can see slowing down by some 12 to 15 orders of magnitude. This slowing down is not accompanied by any major structural change, and this makes it very difficult and very challenging problem to describe. There are connections between dynamics and thermodynamics. So one would really like to develop a unified theoretical description that would cover both dynamics and thermodynamics. One of these connections is closeness of the characteristic temperature that is obtained from the so-called VFT fit to the relaxation time. This is this temperature T naught at which the relaxation time seems to diverge. No divergence has ever been observed, of course, in a lab, because the system falls out of equilibrium before we can reach T0. But we can still measure T0 by fitting the relaxation time data to Fogel-Fulcher fit. And then there is another temperature, characteristic temperature obtained from calorimetric measurements. It's the so-called Kautzmann temperature, which is obtained from by extrapolating supercooled liquids entropy, and then supercooled liquids entropy crosses the entropy of a crystal at the temperature, which since it was first observed by Kautzmann, is called Kautzmann temperature. For many glass formers, these two temperatures are quite close to each other. And this suggests that there is a connection between dynamics and thermodynamics. Now, I should start by acknowledging the drawback or problem with the theories that I will be discussing. They are restricted to the first few decades of the slowing down. So we cannot really describe this whole dynamical range. This is in contrast to the theory that was presented in the first session of this symposium. Ken Schweitzer has a theory that is able to describe 12 to 15 orders of magnitude of change of viscosity. What we are trying to do is develop theories that have other advantages compared to his theory, but these theories are so far restricted to the vicinity or stop working in the vicinity of the so-called critical temperature, which is more or less the same as mode coupling temperature. Still, these theories can describe complete dynamical range of the behavior in glassy colloidal fluids, so there is still some merit in these theories. Now, I told you that the most spectacular dynamical phenomena is the slowing down, but it's not only that dynamics are slowing down, it's what is also interesting is how are they slowing down. So the most prominent effect that is mentioned in this context is the so-called cage effect, the fact that any given particle with decreasing temperature or increasing density stays localized for a longer period of time in a temporary in its temporary position. It's surrounded by its nearest neighbors that form cage, which is pretty stable. And this is reflected in the mean square displacement that is exhibiting this pronounced plateau, and in the in various intermediate scattering function that exhibit two-step decay. Now, the long-time dynamics, which is characterized by long-time diffusion coefficient or the final relaxation time, the long-time dynamics seem to be slowing down as a power law upon approaching characteristic temperature. But then there are deviations from this power loss, which means that this putative transition, as observed in simulations and also in experiments, is really avoided. And what happens beyond this avoided transition is the real problems, the real problem for the theories of the type that I will be describing. Still, these theories can predict some features, as I will show you on the next slide. For example, they can predict the wave vector dependence of this intermediate time plateau. There are other spectacular phenomena that happen upon approaching the glass transition, have significant non-Gaussian behavior. We have dynamic heterogeneity or spatially correlated dynamics. And some of these theories can describe some features of this phenomena, but we still are waiting for a fully unified theory. The class of theories that I will focus on, they typically describe dynamics via a so-called intermediate scattering function, which really is a Fourier transform of the density correlation function. One can derive an exact but formal equation for the evolution of this scattering function, and this equation involves so-called memory function. This is a formal development. Basically, everything that we don't know about dynamics of the system is put into the memory function. We can derive a formal expression for the memory function, and it is expressed in terms of pair density correlation function. So we have a pair of densities at one time correlated with pair density at another time. And this pair density correlation function evolves with the so-called irreducible dynamics, which unfortunately means that it cannot be simulated straightforwardly on a computer. One have to cook up a special simulation procedure which actually doesn't work upon approaching glass transition. But we can make approximations starting from this scheme, and the mode coupling theory, which was developed a long time ago by Professor Goetze, was the first theory that used these approximations in a very constructive way. The main approximation of mode coupling theory is the factorization approximation, namely this per density correlation function is approximated by a product of density correlation functions. I should mention here that factorization approximations are encountered in other areas of theoretical physics, and they are usually interpreted as some kind of mean field-like approximation. So there were already from the very beginning, there were many people that referred to mode coupling theory as the mean field theory of the class transition. Once this approximation is made, we can express a memory function in terms of the scattering functions. There are additional technical approximations, but basically we get a closed system of equations that can be solved. The theory reproduces the two-step decay of the intermediate scattering function. It predicts a real ergodicity breaking transition. So it predicts that this plateau would extend to infinity when the volume fraction, for example, approaches volume fraction, critical volume fraction of the theory. The divergence is that is predicted is a power law divergence with exponent that is quite close to what is observed. The most spectacular success of the theory, which I don't think is completely understood, is for the prediction of this wave vector dependence of this non-ergodicity parameter. The points are obtained from simulations. Line is calculated from the theory. It's really a very good agreement. But the theory has, of course, problems. The main problem, the elephant in the closet, if you want, is the fact that in reality, we don't have an ergodicity breaking transition in three dimensions. The theory cannot really describe correctly non-Gaussian effects. It misses dynamic heterogeneity, etc. Now, some years ago, almost 20 years ago now, I focused on one of the problems, which is that the theory does not predict the location of the transition correctly. And at that time, there was no easy way to improve upon this prediction. So the idea that I had was to make a factorization approximation one step later. So this is sort of a classical approach in statistical mechanics. We try to include some more exact information and make approximations later. So the procedure is like this. One can derive an exact equation of motion for the per density correlation function. And in this new equation of motion, we would get a second order memory function, which then can be factorized into the standard memory function and the correlation function. The resulting equation for the per density correlation function can be solved and then substituted into the expression for the memory function. And we get the following self-consistent equation for the memory function. Now, this equation is quite complicated. Solving this equation would, in a naive way, would require moving between direct space and Laplace space. It's quite a bit more complicated than solving standard mode coupling equations. And when I formulated this theory, I really didn't, I really couldn't solve for the time dependence, but I was able to locate the ergodicity breaking transition and show that the transition moves towards higher volume fractions. And the non-ergodicity parameter is still reasonable. There was a number of papers that followed this work in which people tried to push this transition towards higher and higher orders, and the prediction for the ergodicity breaking transition was still improving. But the major advance in this field came with the work of Lisbeth Janssen, who was then a postdoc with Dave Reichman. She was able to solve the time-dependent equations that follow from this so-called generalized mode coupling theory. And she showed that the time dependence with increasing level of the theory is described better and better. To summarize this part of the development, with increasing level of approximation, we can show that the theory describes better and better computer simulations. The theory still predicts an ergodicity breaking transition. And one of the problems with the theory, and maybe the reason why it still predicts ergodicity breaking transition, is that it only includes some of the dynamic correlations, so-called diagonal dynamic correlations. There is work to include off-diagonal dynamic correlations. I won't talk about this work because I'm not really personally involved in it, but I will now switch gears a tiny bit and talk to you about a related problem, including off-diagonal dynamic correlations in Lorentz gas dynamics. So Lorentz gas dynamics is essentially dynamics of a single particle among fixed randomly distributed obstacles. And the main problem here is the localization transition. With increasing density of these obstacles, particle will eventually get localized in the location of the transition. And what happens upon approaching localization transition, this is what the theory can now analyze. The theory for random Lorentz gas dynamics follows the same steps as the theory for liquids dynamics. So one can introduce self-intermediate scattering function and then derive an exact equation for the self-intermediate scattering function, which will involve a memory function. And the memory function is given in terms of the joint density of the moving particle and the obstacles. One can do factorization and mode coupling theory and then examine the predictions of this theory. Turns out that in three dimensions, the predictions are quite reasonable, but in two dimensions, this theory has a major problem. And this problem is that the problem is that it predicts localization at any non-zero obstacle density, which is clearly unphysical. And GMCT, at least diagonal GMCT, does not help. It's because for this problem, diagonal GMCT is actually equivalent to standard mode coupling theory. So I had a discussion about it some years ago with Thomas, and he suggested that one way to solve this problem would be to include off-diagonal contributions to what we would now call GMCT for random Lorentz gas. So this is the original MCT equation for random Lorentz gas, GMCT equation, so the equation for this per density correlation function. And I, in red, I highlighted the fact that the wave vector is diagonal. Now, if you can include off-diagonal contributions, then you have this integral over all wave vectors. So the wave vectors, all the this per density correlation function at all wave vectors is really explicitly coupled in the equation of motion. It turns out that this off-diagonal theory, it cures the major problem of MCT. There's no spurious transition anymore, but it's actually quite difficult to work out exact numerical consequences of this theory, and this is still an ongoing work. I would like to throw something throw an idea at you, essentially. I think that there is a connection between this off-diagonal contributions and stochastic beta relaxation theory that Tommaso will be talking about. And this is based on basically the structure of the diagrams. The MCT diagram for the memory function is this simple bubble-like diagram. And the simplest off-diagonal contribution is this bubble diagram with one crossing line. And to me, this structure of this diagram is quite similar to what one would get if one considered MCT in a random perturbation that is correlated. So I seem to think that if one could resum off-diagonal contributions, a certain class of diagonal contributions to the memory function, one would get a version of stochastic beta relaxation theory. And that's sort of in the spirit of this symposium, we are trying to make connections between different theories. Now, I want to switch for the last few minutes, I want to switch gears completely and discuss a different approach to the dynamics of glassy fluids, which has become known as the dynamic mean field theory. And to motivate this development, I should recall another person who was influential in the field, David Chandler, who once, many years ago, when I was still a graduate student, asked me the following question. Is there a system for which mode coupling theory is exact? We always try to find, when we formulate mean field theories, we always try to find systems for which a specific mean field theory is exact. these systems are sort of then become a workhorse or testing ground for various approximations. At that time, it was not clear whether there is such a system. The hypothesis that was put forward, I was not aware of it, but it was put forward more or less at the same time, put forward by Ted Kirkpatrick and Peter Wallinus, was that mode coupling theory should become exact in the limit of high spatial dimension, and it should become equivalent to a static theory of the glass transition that the same people developed in collaboration with Dave Thirumalai. I should mention that since that time, the static theory has been completely developed. It started in the replica language. It started from the work of Mezart and Parisi, and then Parisi and Zamponi, and then Kuchan, Parisi, Urbani, and Zamponi proved that this static mean field theory of the glass transition becomes really exact in the limit of high spatial dimensions. It is a fully unified theory in that it predicts so-called dynamic transition at which ergodicity is broken, which we know doesn't happen in three dimensions, but in the limit of infinite spatial dimensions, it does. And it also predicts Kautzmann transition, which is which corresponds to this Kautzmann temperature that I mentioned at the very beginning. Now, the problem for the MCT appeared at more or less the same time as the static theory was formulated, namely, Atsushi Ikeda and Kunio Miyazaki showed that MCT becomes, as some people like to put it, infinitely wrong in infinite spatial dimension. To put it in a different language, MCT predicts a different scaling law for the dimensional dependence of the dynamic transition from the replica theory. And the difference becomes larger and larger with increasing dimension. And this led to this memorable opinion piece of Jean-Philippe, who questioned the very premise of mode coupling theory. Now, since that time, dynamics of the infinite dimensional Hartree-Fields system has been solved. It was first solved by a very complicated Python integral calculation, but then a simpler cavity style derivation was proposed. This cavity style derivation was just an approximate derivation, but we, together with Giulio Biroli, Dave Reichman, and Chen Liu, I was able to like patch this derivation, and also we were able to come up with projection operator style derivation. This thing is more or less very well understood right now. So how does this theory work? First, one can show exactly that in the limit of high spatial dimension, the single particle dynamics can be described by this generalized Langevin equation, which involves a memory function and Gaussian noise with correlations that are given by the memory function. Now, memory function is determined by the dynamics of the relative coordinates, so the distance between two particles. And the distance, this relative coordinate, the distance between two particles evolves according to the equation that involves memory function, the same memory function. So these two equations, they form a system, a closed system of equations that allow you to calculate self-consistently the memory function. Once this is done, this can be done only numerically. Once this is done, one can actually go back to the equation for the dynamics of the single particle and analyze particles' dynamics. So the essential features of this theory seem to be that we have a self-consistent equation at the level of the memory function, and the two particle dynamics is included exactly. And this including two particle dynamics exactly is evident from this term here. We have exact two particle force that influences the dynamics of the relative coordinate. So if we compare this with generalized mode coupling theory, I mean, there are some similarities. The GMCT also imposes self-consistency at the level of the memory function. However, it doesn't include direct interactions between two density fluctuations. So the idea, the simplest idea how to cure this problem of GMCT, that like MCT, it doesn't lead to a correct solution in the limit of infinite special dimensions. The simplest idea was to add direct interactions to the GMCT equations. This is actually quite complicated, and I won't even try to show you the equations. I will show you the theory that I'm proposing for random Lorentz gas. This equation for the two-particle density correlation can be obtained, which involves a memory function. And this equation involves direct correlations, direct interactions between the moving particle and one of the obstacles. Now, the consequences of this equation still have to be worked out. And the last element, the last avenue to extend dynamic mean field theory, which really works only in the limit of infinite spatial dimension, which is the subject of collaboration that I'm involved in, is the so-called cluster DMFT. This is inspired by DMFT for correlated electrons. And basically the idea is that in DMFT, we treat dynamics of one particle only, self-consistently, but in reality, we have dynamic correlations, but this dynamic, the range of these dynamic correlations is pretty small, even very close to the glass transition. So can we include them perturbatively by considering clusters of particles moving in a sea of other clusters? This leads to so-called cluster DMFT. We wrote down equations for this cluster DMFT in this archive contribution, but we have not worked out the consequences of these equations. So I'm very much aware that I posed more questions than I gave you answers. The questions or the directions for future work is how to include off-diagonal dynamic correlations in generalized mode coupling theory. Is it possible to connect these off-diagonal correlations somehow with stochastic beta relaxation that we will hear about in a couple of minutes. I proposed a new theory for random Lorentz gas that sort of merges some ideas from generalized mode coupling theory with ideas from dynamic mean field theory that works in the infinite spatial dimension. Its predictions need to be worked out. Similar theory can be formulated for the dynamics of Hart sphere liquid, but it will involve higher order static correlations and then necessitate some additional approximations. And finally, we have this cluster extension of DMFT. So these are the directions for future work. I would welcome very much any suggestions and comments. Thank you.
Grzegorz, thank you very much for a very nice talk. And we have a few minutes for a couple of questions. Does anyone want to ask? Hello, Magdaleno?
I have several questions, but I cannot formulate them very precisely. I think that we can also ask questions in the end of the session in case you there is this time that we decided.
Okay, if not, I do have a question, Grzegorz. In your theory or the theory that the Lorentz gas description and so on, is this a trick of taking into account non-diagonal elements somehow related to taking like effects induced by the confining media, or where does the influence of the confining media enters? Let's say, where should it... Should I notice, for instance, the difference between an ordered medium and a disordered medium, a fractal confinement, and so on?
Okay, so the theory that I presented is presented only for random Lorentz gas, so the medium is the particles of the medium are completely uncorrelated. The correlations between particles of the medium would show up in this factorization approximation. So here I don't have any correlations between particles of the medium, and therefore there is nothing that can show up. But if there are correlations distribution. So for example, if the particles of the medium are distributed according to the equilibrium distribution, then I would have another factor here, which would be essentially the structure factor of the medium. Now, whether this theory is able to distinguish, to describe fractal media, I am not sure, but since this fractal dimension will show up in one way or another in the structure factor, this can be investigated.